हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द टॉपिक फेडरलिज्म। इन दिस चैप्टर वी विल कवर व्हाट इज फेडरलिज्म, द नीड फॉर फेडरलिज्म एंड हाउ इज फेडरलिज्म सक्सेसफुल। मूविंग फॉरवर्ड, लेट अस कॉन्सेंट्रेट ऑन व्हाट इज फेडरलिज्म। फेडरलिज्म इज अ सिस्टम ऑफ गवर्नमेंट इन विच द पावर इज डिवाइडेड बिटवीन अ सेंट्रल अथॉरिटी एंड वेरियस कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट यूनिट्स ऑफ द कंट्री। That means federalism is a kind of arrangement in which the power of administration is divided among its constituents. For example, the power of a country like India, in India, the power is divided among the state government, also on the local level of the Panchayati Raj. So such a division of power in a government is known as federalism or federal government. Levels of government in a federation. So there are always obviously some kind of levels available in every kind of arrangement. So there are different levels in a federal government. So for example, we have different levels in courts, we have different levels in official government, in government officers we have different levels. Same wise in a federation we have different level of government. So usually a federation has two levels of government. Government for the entire country, that is usually responsible for the subjects related to the whole nation, that we in short call as the central government. The central government is responsible for all the decisions which will directly or indirectly affect the country. So such kind of government, such kind of arrangement is known as the central government, which affects the decision of whole country. Then the power is also divided into the state-wise level, that is a province or the level of states, which we in our country call as the state government. So this state government is responsible for the day-to-day activities, the decision pertaining to the day-to-day activities of the state. Moving ahead, we'll also see the key features of federalism, that is the importance of federalism in a democratic country like ours. So there are two or more levels of government. There are always two or more levels of government in a federal country. Like we have central government, state government and a local government, which is also known as the Panchayati Raj. Different tiers of government govern the same citizen, but each tier has its own jurisdiction in specific matters of legislation, taxation and administration. So different types of government govern the citizens, whatever type of arrangement it may be of central or state or local, its sole responsibility is to govern the citizen, make sure that citizen do not face any problem. So whatever kind of government we are having, its main aim is to provide facilities for the citizens, though it may be of a central, it may be of a state, or it may be of a local level of administration. So different types of government govern the same citizen, but it has its own jurisdiction, that means it has its own limitations like taxation, legislation and administration. It will work only according to their area. They cannot cross their borders. They have limitations on which matter they can work. The jurisdictions of the respective levels of government are specified in the constitution. So the existence and the authority of each tier of government is constitutionally guaranteed. So the existence of such tier is given in the constitution. The powers of the various levels of government is already mentioned in the constitution. So this is 100% certified way of arrangement of power, which our constitutional guarantees or the constitutional approves a method which can be followed in the country. The fundamental provision of constitution cannot be unilaterally changed by one level of government. Such changes require the consent of both levels of the government. So if the local government decides to change some fundamental policy of the constitution, it cannot do. Unilaterally means alone. So alone a government cannot change any decision in the constitution. It cannot alter any phrase of the constitution. It has to get the approval of both the levels. So if the Panchayati Raj wants to have a new clause added in the constitution, it has to call for the both central and state government to decide upon it. One alone cannot change the whole constitution. So in a way, our constitution also guarantees in this manner that none of the level of the government takes liberty or bends the rule on their own for their own benefit. And moreover, as we all know, our country is a democratic country. Whatever decisions we take or the government takes, it should benefit the people. That is our sole motto of our constitution. Moving forward, courts also have the power to interpret the constitution and power of different levels of government. The highest court acts as an umpire if disputes arise between different levels of government in the exercise of their respective powers. So like we have two different types of government working. One is the central, one is the state. So there might be a chance where the central government might frame some rules which may not be okay for the state governments. So in such case, there might be a difference of opinion. So we need an umpire or a referee who will give the proper judgment after hearing the both the cases. So in this point, we introduce the courts, which acts as an umpire between the both the government if they have any kind of dispute regarding a rule, regarding a law or any affair. So the highest court, that is our Supreme Court, acts as an umpire between the various level of governments in case they have any kind of dispute with their powers or functioning. And sources of revenue for each level of government are clearly specified to ensure its financial autonomy. That means even the revenue, how will the state government get its revenue, how will central government get its revenue, all these are clearly mentioned in our constitution. They ensure that there is a smooth functioning and there is always a financial autonomy. Financial autonomy in the sense, the state government need not to produce or give all the tax it collects to the central government. The same central government need not to give with all the tax which is collected to the state government. So they have their own limitations and they have their own freedom. Now the best part is all these have been already mentioned in our constitution. The powers have been equally divided, and it's also seen that all the powers which central government has, state government also possess the same kind of power, but at a bit lower level. Next, moving ahead, federal government thus has dual objectives. Dual in the sense, two objectives. It has to do dual role. That is, first, to safeguard and promote unity of the country, while at the same time accommodate regional diversity. So we have different states, and most of the states are divided on the basis of language. And even though we have divided on the basis of language, we are having different community of people, different regional people living in the same state. So now the government also, the federal government, the federal system also has to take care that we live along different community people together, that we are happy in our diversity. So to accommodate the diversity and to maintain the unity of the people, it's a very challenging task, as we all know. So federal system also has to ensure that we different type of people are living together in the same country or in the same state without having any difference of opinion. Therefore, two aspects are crucial for institution and practice of federalism. Governments at different levels should agree to some rules of power sharing. So there should be always some agreement between the state and the central. So if they don't agree on a common point, there is no point in having the division or the power sharing. So central government, if it says something, and if state government has a different opinion, they should soon form a single common opinion which will help the citizen of the country to function better. They should also trust that each would abide by its part of agreement. An ideal federal system has both aspects, mutual trust and agreement to live together. So this is the to put it in a nutshell, there should be mutual trust between the various levels of government and an agreement to live together. See, we cannot make law where central government says that every state government should compulsorily follow, because state government knows its people better. So even the central government should look for the problematic areas where a state government can find it difficult to handle. So they should have an easy way where they can accommodate the state diversity as well as they can function with the central level of administration. So this kind of arrangement, that is, there should be always a trust between the state and the central government, and also they should promote each other's growth. So this is one of the main objective of the federal system. So coming to the topic, types of federations. So federation can be of two types, coming together and holding together. As the name itself suggests, coming together federation means independent states coming together on their own to form a bigger unit. So all these individual states, doesn't matter whatever size they are of, but these individual states, they come together, they voluntarily come together and form a single unit, a single country. It's like different bricks coming together to make a single wall. In this way, all these little states, when they come together to form one single country, their power is getting united, their resources are now plentiful, they can help each other in ways of social security, their identity and sovereignty. So they can protect their identity as well. Their resources are now pooled into one single power. So the aspect of growth increases in such countries. So this kind of arrangement is known as coming together, where individual states come together to form a single country. Example, USA, Switzerland and Australia. The next we are going to discuss is the holding together federation. Now here, it's little bit different from coming together. Here, one holds the states together. That is, the power is divided from central level to state level. For example, India, where a central government works, but the state level also has its own function, its own responsibility, which it should do it properly. Example, India, Spain and Belgium. So it is very much clear from these two type of federation. One is coming together, another is holding together. In coming together federation, the states voluntarily come together to form a single country. The powers of different states are together consolidated to form a single country. Whereas in holding together federation, the powers are divided among the various states of the country. So in this way, if the power is divided, the responsibility is divided, the working is smooth now, the decision can be easily taken. So such kind of arrangement is known as holding together arrangement. Example is India, Spain and Belgium. So next topic we will discuss about the three list of the constitution, in which we will see about union list, state list and the concurrent list. I hope you understood this video. See you in another video. Thank you. Take care.